Welcome to the Shepherd's Chapel Network Family Bible Study Hour with Pastor Dennis Murray. Wisdom is understanding God's Word. Pastor Murray's unique teaching approach brings God's Word alive with meaning as he takes you on a chapter-by-chapter, verse-by-verse study of God's letter to you, the Bible. And now, here is Pastor Dennis Murray.
Good day to you. God bless you. Welcome to Shepherd's Chapel. Welcome to this family Bible study hour. Ready to get back into our Father's Word here at the chapel? We invite you to get your Bible and join us if you care to. We're going to pick it up today, 2 Kings chapter 7, verse 5. And we left Israel, Samaria, in a bad situation as we ended our last lecture. Things are not going well at all. First, the Syrians came against Israel, the capital Samaria, and besieged it. That means they surrounded it, and nothing came in, including food, and nothing went out. And it has gotten so bad that there's a famine in Samaria. And it says, it's written in chapter 6, that an ass's head sold for 80 pieces, that's 80 pieces of silver, and a cab or a quart of dove's dung, which was some kind of vegetable, sold for 5 pieces of silver. And it got so bad that the people of Israel, there were two women, each of them had a son, and they made an agreement, and they said, well, let's kill your son, and we'll boil him and eat him today, and tomorrow we'll kill the other one's son, and that way at least we'll have something to eat for 2 days. Well, they killed the one and boiled him, and then the second one backed out on the deal and hid her son. But Jehoram, the king of Israel, had given up on the Lord delivering them from the famine or the Syrians. And fact is, he threatened Elisha's head as a result. He's given up on any type of forgiveness or deliverance. But with that, Elisha made the prophecy, by this time tomorrow, a measure, which is a peck of fine flour, will be sold for 1 shekel, and 2 measures of barley for 1 shekel. In other words, food is going to return to normal pricing. And as the very last of our last lecture, we had 4 lepers who were at the gate of Samaria begging. And they're talking among themselves, and they said, you know, why are we sitting here begging? The people of Samaria, the city, are starving to death, and we expect them to give us something? We're going to just starve to death if we don't do something. And they decided, well, if we went to the Syrians and basically threw ourselves at their mercy, perhaps they would show us favor and give us something to eat and drink. That's where we left it off. Let's ask that word of wisdom in Yeshua's precious name. Father, we ask you to open eyes, open ears this day as we pick it up. 2 Kings chapter 7, verse 5, and it reads, and they, this being the 4 leprous men, rose up in the twilight in the evening to go unto the camp of the Syrians. And when they were come to the uttermost, or the outermost part of the camp of Syria, behold, there was no man there. The camp was there. The asses and the horses were still tied up. They probably had campfires going, ready to cook the evening meal, but there is not one man in sight. Verse 6, for the Lord had made the host of the Syrians to hear a noise of chariots and a noise of horses. Note the repetition, it emphasizes. Even the noise of a great host, of a great army. And they said one to another, lo, the king of Israel, it's Jehoram, hath hired against us the kings, note the plural, there was more than one tribe, of the Hittites, these being located to the north of Israel, and the kings of the Egyptians, located to the south of Israel, to come upon us. And this, I think, is a bit ironic. In chapter 6, verse 18, at the word of Elisha, God closed the eyes of this same Syrian army. Now God has opened their ears to where they've heard the noise of chariots and horses and a great host. And probably the army, of, I have no doubt, is the same army that Elisha prayed that his servant, his eyes would be opened from Dothan, the Mount of Dothan, and could see the army of God circling the mountain. Verse 7, wherefore they arose, again speaking of the four lepers, and fled in the twilight. No, I should say this is the Syrian army. They arose and fled in the twilight, in the evening, and left their tents and their horses and their asses, even the camp as it was, and fled for their life. Seasoned soldiers running scared, fleeing for their very lives. Verse 8. And when these lepers came to the uttermost, again the outermost part of the camp, they went into one tent and did eat and drink. They were starving to death, so they're taking care of first things first. And carried thence silver and gold and raiment, and went and hid it, and came again and entered into another tent, and carried thence also, and went and hid it, a lot of spoil. There are tens of thousands of Syrian soldiers. There's no telling how many tents were there. They probably could have gone on, the four lepers could have gone on for weeks hiding silver and gold. They're not going to do it. Verse 9, then they said one to another, we do not well. What we're doing isn't right. This day is a day of good tidings, and we hold our peace. We're not telling the other people of Samaria. If we tarry till the morning light, some mischief will come upon us. Some punishment is going to find us, in the Hebrew. Now therefore come, that we may go and tell the king's household. Let's tell everyone else the good news. The Syrian army is gone. The siege of Samaria is over. The famine, therefore, is over. You see, there wasn't a lack of food in the 10 tribes to the north. It was simply that the Syrian army had surrounded Samaria to where nobody could get in or out. So the famine is about to be over, and there's a lot of spoil, silver and gold as well. Verse 10. So they came and called unto the porter of the city. A porter you could think of as a gatekeeper. And they told them, saying, we came to the camp of the Syrians. No doubt it's probably dark at this point, so the city gate, the gate porter would be on duty. And behold, there was no man there, neither voice of man, but horses tied and asses tied, and the tents as they were. Everything was as they left it. They didn't take anything with them except what they could carry, and they were running for it. They left everything behind. Verse 11, and he called the porters, this being the porters of the king's house, the porter of the gate called the king's porters, in other words, gatekeepers, and they told it to the king's house within. And Jehoram is going to be very suspicious. He's going to think that the Syrians have set up a trap for the people of Samaria. Verse 12, and the king arose in the night and said unto his servants, I will now show you what the Syrians have done to us. They know that we are hungry. They know we're starving to death. Therefore are they gone out of the camp to hide themselves in the field, saying, when they come out of the city, we shall catch them alive and get into the city. It's a trick. Jehoram's not looking for an answer to prayer, and brought on by the prayer and humility of Israel. he thinks that the Syrians are going to coax them out of behind their walled city of Samaria, and then when they're out in the field, they'll sneak in and have the walled city to fight and probably kill us from. Verse 13, and one of his servants answered and said, let some take, I pray thee, 5 of the horses that remain, which are left in the city. Behold, they are as all the multitude of Israel that are left in it. Behold, I say, they are even as all the multitude of the Israelites that are consumed, those who have already died, and let us send and see. You know, we're going to sit here and starve to death anyway. Let's, you know, okay, if we don't send everybody out, the Syrians can't come in and take the walled city, which was one of Jehoram's suspicions. So let's just send out 5 spies to see what's going on and what the reaction is. And if the Syrians catch those 5 and kill them, probably better off for those 5. Starvation is a very, very slow death. Verse 14. They took therefore 2 chariot horses. This would be 2 teams of chariot horses. And a team of for chariots would be either 2 horses or 3. And the king sent after the host of the Syrians, saying, go and see. Check out what the Syrians are doing. Are the lepers telling us the truth? And is it really not a trick by the Syrians? And they went after them unto Jordan. And lo, all the way was full of garments and vessels, which the Syrians had cast away in their haste. And the messengers returned and told the king. This is good news for all. The enemy, the Syrians, are gone. The famine is over. And again, the famine wasn't due to the fact that there was no food in the land of Israel, the 10 tribes to the north. The famine was because they couldn't get food into the city of Samaria. These garments and vessels that were scattered along the roads to leading to Jordan, of course, that would be where they were trying to get to escape this army that they heard the chariots and the horses of. But no doubt the Lord was making it to where every time they slowed down, their ears were opened up and the sound of the chariots and the horses and the great host sounded like it was even closer. And so the Syrian army, carrying what they could carry with them, would throw away the garments and vessels, trying to lose weight so they could make better time to escape. Verse 16, and the people went out and spoiled the tents of the Syrians, these being the people of Samaria. So a measure of fine flour was sold for a shekel, and 2 measures of barley for a shekel, according to the word of the Lord. And according to the word of Elisha, which was the word of the Lord. He said, within this time tomorrow, a measure of fine flour will sell for 1 shekel, 2 measures of barley for 1 shekel. Prices are going to stabilize and the famine is over. You remember in verse 2, there was one who mocked Elisha when he said this. And he said, you know, will the Lord open the windows of heaven that this may be? The prophecy of Elijah, he's mocking Elisha, and therefore he's mocking God. Everyone thinks that this is good news, but the one who said this. You remember what Elisha said to him when he mocked him. He said, you know, this is going to come to pass, and you're going to see it, but you are not going to eat thereof. Verse 17, and the king appointed the Lord on whose hand he leaned, one of his servants, in other words, guess which one, to have the charge of the gate. Here, control these mad crowds of people who have been starving to death for weeks, and now they hear that there's food in the Syrian camp. Guard this gate and keep it under control. And the people trode upon him in the gate, and he died, as the man of God, that's Elisha, had said, who spake when the king came down to him. And again, that happened in verse 1 or in 2 of this same chapter. But God's word always comes to pass. The prophecies of a true prophet always come to pass. Verse 18, and it came to pass, as the man of God had spoken to the king, Jehoram, saying, 2 measures of barley for a shekel, and a measure of fine flour for a shekel, shall be tomorrow about this time in the gate, which is the marketplace of Samaria, exactly as spoken. Verse 19, and that Lord answered the man of God and said, now behold, if the Lord, and this is kind of going back and reviewing it one more time, the Lord should make windows in heaven, might such a thing be? And remember, he said this very sarcastically and mockingly. And he said, behold, or look, Elisha, to the man who mocked him, thou shalt see it with thine eyes, but shalt not eat thereof. Verse 20 to end the chapter. And so it fell out unto him, for the people trode upon him in the gate, and he died. Now, chapter 8, we come to a parenthetical chapter. Don't let this throw you. We're going to back up in time at least 7 years, possibly a little bit longer than that. And we can prove that as we make our way through the chapter. I'll be sure and point that out as we cover it. Let's go with chapter 8, verse 1. Then spake Elisha unto the woman whose son he had restored to life. This is the Shunammite woman. You remember that they built a room onto her house, and Elisha, as he was traveling back and forth between the cities where the school of the sons of the prophets were located, would stop and eat, saying, arise and go thou and thine household, and sojourn wheresoever thou canst sojourn, for the Lord hath called for a famine that had already begun, and it shall also come upon the land 7 years. Now this is not to be confused with the famine that we saw in chapter 7, which again was just for the city of Samaria. This famine that Elisha is warning the Shunammites about is going to cover the entire nation, and he's encouraging her to take her family and flee, because there's going to be a famine and it's going to be bad, is what he would say. Remember this woman too, Elisha sent Gehazi, his servant, to her and asked, what can I do for you? Is there a request that I can make to the king or perhaps the general of the armies for you? And she said, no, I'm happy. I'm a happy lady. Everything's going good. And that's when Gehazi told Elisha that, hey, they're an older couple and they don't have any children. And Elisha prophesied that about this time next year, you'll give birth to a son. And the son is the one that she's talking about in this verse. And the son died of a heat stroke, and Elisha, through a miraculous event, brought the young man back to God. I should say, God, using Elisha, brought the youth back to life. The famine's going to be a bad one, though. Verse 2. And the woman arose and did after the saying of the man of God. She obeyed Elisha. And she went with her household and sojourned in the land of the Philistines 7 years. And to sojourn means that they were immigrants. They were foreigners in to the Philistines, residing in their land. Verse 3. And it came to pass at the 7 years' end And that the woman returned out of the land of the Philistines, and she went forth to cry unto the king, or petition unto the king for her house and for her land. She'd been gone 7 years, someone else has moved into her home, and she's petitioning the king that she be there, that her inheritance in the land of Israel be returned to her. Now, this happened before Naaman, the general of the Syrian army, was healed of his leprosy. The next verse will prove it. Verse 4. And the king talked with Gehazi. This is Jehoram speaking with Gehazi, the servant of the man of God. He was not the servant of the man of God after Naaman was healed and Gehazi got greedy and tried to claim some of the gifts that Naaman brought for Elisha for healing him, saying, tell me, I pray thee, all the great things that Elisha hath done. Now, this also before Gehazi struck with leprosy, which was on Naaman. And after seeing the true character of Gehazi in the events surrounding Naaman's healings, it's easy for us to understand these next several verses. You see, Jehoram is an enemy of Elisha. Elisha is his master. You remember when Jehoram and Jehoshaphat and the deputy king of Edom were going to fight against the Moabites and there was no water. And what did Elisha say to Jehoram? He said, you son of a murderer, if it weren't for Jehoshaphat here, I would ignore you. I wouldn't see you. I wouldn't even speak to you. So Jehoram is kind of milking Gehazi for information concerning Elisha. And again, we see the nature of Gehazi coming out. Gehazi's going to play along, hoping for a reward. Verse 5. And it came to pass, as he was telling the king, this is Gehazi, how he had restored a dead body to life, that behold, the woman whose son he had restored to life cried to the king for her house and for her land. And Gehazi said, my lord, O king, this is the woman, and this is her son whom Elisha restored to life. Isn't that coincidental? Here we were just talking about this, the youth being brought back to life, and here is the Shunammite woman and her son. Verse 6, and when the king asked the woman, she told him, and she asked him that she wanted to reclaim her land, in other words. So the king appointed unto her a certain officer, saying, restore all that was hers and all the fruits, in other words, all the produce of the field since the day that she left the land, even until now. And Jehoram not only restoring her home and the land, he's demanding that whoever was there restore the produce from the land for the entire 7 years that she was gone. And of course, as severe as the famine was in the land, that probably wasn't much. In chapter 3, verses 16 and 19, Elisha saved Jehoram and Jehoshaphat and the deputy king of Edom's bacon. I think Jehoram thinks that it felt like he owed Elisha a favor, and he knew that this woman was favored, the Shunammite woman was favored by Elisha, and that's what he's trying to gain favor with Elisha. Verse 7, and Elisha came to Damascus, that's the king of Syria, and Ben-Hadad, the king of Syria, was sick. Now, these are the enemy of Israel, don't forget. And it was told him, saying, the man of God is come hither. Elisha, the prophet of Israel, is here in Damascus. Verse 8, and the king said unto Hazael, take a present in thine hand, and go meet the man of God, and inquire of the Lord by him, saying, shall I recover of this disease? Now, this is very ironic. Do you remember how we began the book of 2 Kings? You remember a king of Israel by the name of Ahaziah, who fell through the lattice work and was injured. And what did he do? Well, he sent to the god of Ekron, a heathen nation, to inquire of their gods, Beelzebub, as to whether he would recover from his illness. Now we have a king of a heathen nation, the Syrians, inquiring of a true prophet of God. I find a lot of irony in that. Verse 9. So Hazael went to meet him, Elisha, and took a present with him. Do you think Elisha would take a present from Hazael after Naaman brought a load and he refused? Even of every good thing of Damascus, 40 camels burden, and came and stood before him and said, thy son Ben-Hadad, king of Syria, hath sent me to see thee, to thee, saying, shall I recover of this disease? Now, does the name Hazael ring a bell? Well, it should. You remember, as we were introduced to Elijah in 1 Kings, one of the instructions that God gave to Elijah was to anoint Hazael king of Syria, and he was to anoint Jehu king of Israel, and he was to anoint Elisha as his replacement, a prophet of the Lord. Elijah accomplished only one of those three. Elisha will accomplish the latter two over the next several chapters in the book of 2 Kings. Verse 10, and Elisha said unto him, go say unto him, thou mayest certainly recover. Howbeit the Lord hath showed me that he shall surely die. The disease, he would have recovered from it, but the king of Syria, Ben-Hadad, is about to be murdered. This 40 camels burden, by the way, this simply means the load that the camels were capable of bearing. That would be a great deal, 40 of every good thing of Damascus. But he's going to have good news. Hazael's going to have good news and bad news for Ben-Hadad. Verse 11, and he, this being Elisha, settled his countenance steadfastly. This means that he locked eyes on Hazael until he, Hazael, was ashamed, and the man of God wept. Elisha had seen, God had shown Elisha the things that Hazael would bring upon Israel. And the reason Elisha is weeping is for the evil and the calamity that will come upon the people of Israel in the not too distant future. Verse 12, and Hazael said, why weepeth my Lord? Question, what's wrong, Elisha? And he answered, because I know the evil or calamity that thou wilt do unto the children of Israel. Their strongholds wilt thou set on fire, and their young men wilt thou slay with the sword, and wilt dash their children, and rip up their women with child. And God continues to chastise Israel with the army of Syria. And you know, if Israel had done the way God asked them to do, if they would have simply obeyed his commandments and worshiped him, rather than running to the gods of the other nations, starting with Jeroboam making the two golden calves, one in Bethel and one in Dan. And you had Ahab was a Baal worshiper, not a Yahweh worshiper. So God will chastise his children until they finally wake up and change their way. These events would come to pass. Verse 13. And Hazael said, "But what is thy servant, a dog, that he should do this great thing?" He's faking to be humble a little bit here. And Elisha answered, "The Lord hath showed me that thou shalt be king over Syria, and it will come to pass." You see, Hazael is a servant to Ben-Hadad at this time, but he's just now learning that he is Ben-Hadad's replacement. Verse 14, so he departed from Elisha and came to his master, this being Ben-Hadad, the king of Syria, who said to him, "What said Elisha to thee?" And he's anxiously awaiting the return of Hazael. And he answered, "He told me that thou shouldest surely recover." Well, now that's partially true. Elisha did tell him that he could recover of his illness, although he's going to be murdered. Hazael didn't tell him that part. Verse 15, and it came to pass on the morrow that he, this being Hazael, took a thick cloth, this being one that's very closely woven, and dipped it in water and spread it on his, this being Ben-Hadad's face, so that he died, and Hazael reigned in his stead. He murdered him. Now, you know, this is part of God's plan, though, that what Hazael did was smother him. You know, I guess this is where the idea of waterboarding came in, to torture or to question severely, maybe a better term, the enemies of this. But his intention was to kill Ben-Hadad. Why? Because Elisha had told him that he would be the king of Syria. Well, how will this turn out? In our next lecture, we're going to go back a little bit into normal time, and we're going to move back over to Judah, where we've got things going on there as well. So that's a good place to stop for today. So we've got a short message. We'll ask you to listen a moment, won't you please?
Genesis 1:46, the first six chapters in God's Word, the world that was. Did you realize there was a world age before this one? Same old world, different age. The creation itself. When were the races created? You see, all the races were created separately, and you'll find that documented in these particular CDs. How and what was the sin in the garden? It will be discussed in this series also. This is a must for the serious Bible scholar. For if you do not understand how it was in the beginning, you certainly will never understand the end. I think you will find this series very rewarding and certainly will answer questions that no doubt you have always wondered about. Genesis 1:46. Hey, I know you're going to enjoy this series.
Welcome back. We're glad you could join back with us. Let's have the 800 number, please. 800-643-4645. That number good throughout Puerto Rico, the U.S. and Canada. If you have a biblical question that you'd like to pose to be answered on the air, feel free to call that number and leave your question. Please don't ask questions about a specific individual, denomination, or organization by name. We teach God's Word in a positive manner. Throwing out negative about others serves no purpose. We simply won't do it. If you're studying via the internet somewhere around the world and unable to use that 800 number, your announcer at the end of the hour will give you our mailing address. Quite all right to mail your questions in, being the point. Got a prayer request? We can do away with the telephone number. You won't need your telephone. You won't need a mailing address. Your Heavenly Father developed a way for you to talk with Him anytime, anywhere, day or night. It's called prayer. And I encourage you to talk with your Heavenly Father. And when you've got a need in your life, you know, God owns everything. And He's powerful enough that He can change the minds of men. So when you need something, if you love and serve Him, don't hesitate to ask. He gives freely, and He enjoys giving to those who love and serve Him. We do have these prayer requests. Father, we come united as one in the name of Your Son, Jesus Christ. We ask You to look upon these, Father. You know their needs, marital problems, financial difficulties, Father, You know. We also lift up our military troops who are in harm's way around the world, Father. Watch over, guide, protect, touch, heal. In Jesus' precious name, amen and thank you, Father. And this is from, I don't know, somebody shared this. This is not really a question, but I thought it was true. It states, Alcoholics Anonymous, that's AA, won't keep you from going to hell, nor is it a ticket to heaven, but it will keep you sober long enough for you to make up your mind which way you want to go. And thanks, whoever sent that in. That's very true. It needs to be a sober decision. Peggy in South Carolina, as we get to our questions, when people go to heaven, can they see us here that remain on earth? And no, I don't believe that they can any more than we can see into their dimension. Unless God wants one who is in that dimension to see into this, or vice versa. God can allow that, and there are recorded instances in the Bible where men have been allowed to see into that dimension. It doesn't happen very often, though. Then there's always a reason that God wants communicated. Dan in Missouri, is the World Wide Web in the Bible? Does the Bible speak of nuclear power plants? No and no. Charles in Nevada, do you have to be circumcised to go to heaven? No, the blood ordinances of which circumcision is one of, they were nailed to the cross with Jesus, Colossians chapter 2, verse 14. Today's circumcision is one of the heart, and it's a circumcision not made with hands, and it is for both men and women, Romans chapter 2, verse 29. Goldie from Pennsylvania, is it all right to say bless you when someone sneezes? Well, of course it's all right to say bless you when someone sneezes. It's a tradition, I think, probably would be a good word, that is wishing good health, better health. And in fact, the Germans have a saying, Gesundheit. And Gesundheit in the German language, when someone sneezes, they say this, and it means good health. Gesund is good, height is health. In fact, there's a place that made me, your question made me think about, there's an area in Bavaria, just outside of Munich, there's a little town called Landshut that my wife and I were touring, and I thought it was kind of amusing, and it catches your attention very quickly. Rather than saying Guten Tag, which would be, or Guten Abend, which would be a normal greeting as you entered a store, for example. Rather than saying that, though, in this area of Bavaria, they say Gruß Gott, which means greet God. If you see God, greet Him for me, is what they're saying. Nick in Florida. Nothing wrong with saying God bless you. Nick in Florida, in Hebrews 11:34, it speaks of armies of aliens. Is this proof that we're not alone? I personally believe God is much, much bigger than most think. I would agree with you on the latter part, Nick. No, the armies of aliens in Hebrews 11:34 aren't talking about weird looking space creatures that are not from Earth. It's talking the aliens there are foreigners. And we're not alone. God is in heaven, and so are all of those who have yet to be born on earth, and all of those who were born on earth and have died are with him. And this is obviously from a child. I can tell because I think it's written in crayon. And this is from Dagon, I believe. I hope I'm pronouncing that right. In Mississippi, and Dagon asked, why did the bad people kill Jesus? Well, that's a good question, Dagon. And they killed Jesus to fulfill prophecy. You see, God wanted his son to be killed on the cross. Why? Because that was his method of salvation for our sins. Psalm 22. In the Old Testament, 1,000 years before Jesus was actually crucified on the cross, tells of the crucifixion, even down to the Roman soldiers casting lots or gambling for his clothing. Isaiah 53 tells us that Jesus would be placed in the tomb of a rich man, Joseph of Arimathea. It came to pass. And all of that had to happen so that we could be forgiven of our sins. And I'm going to guess that Gavin is a brother to Dagon because it's the same crayon from Mississippi. Why did God write the Bible? Well, God wrote the Bible, Gavin, to tell us how we should live and how to be happy and to be blessed. Here in the flesh on earth. If we do things his way, which he tells us in the Bible, how to do things his way, we'll be blessed and we'll be happy. If we don't do things his way, we're not going to be happy. Dave and Christine from California, there have been eclipses every 6 months on religious holidays for the past year or so. Are these biblical? Well, God told us in Genesis chapter 1, verse 14, through his servant Moses, that the lights of heaven are there for signs and seasons. Watch, watchmen, watch. Darla in California, Ezekiel chapter 40. I thought it is during the millennium. Then why are there sacrifices being done in chapter 44. Thank you for helping me with this question. I pray to hear. Again, bless you for loving Christ, I think this says. All right, and we do love Christ, and I know you do too as well, Darla. And what you, for those who don't know, Ezekiel chapter 40 to the end of the book, which is chapter 48, is all in the millennial period. And Darla's correct that in chapter 44, it speaks of sacrifices. But at that point in time, what you have to understand is that there are no flesh beings on earth any longer. Everything, including animals, is in a spiritual body. And the sacrifice that Father wants at that point in time is the same sacrifice that he wants now. Hosea chapter 6:6, God says, I would rather have your mercy, your love, and for you to have knowledge of my word than burnt offerings. Deborah in Texas, thank you for my Bible studies. They get me through the weekend because I do not get you but 5 days a week. My question is ISIS not a part of the fifth seal where they are going to take over, you say Mount Sinai, I think you mean Sion, God's mountain before Satan gets here, or am I losing it wrong? No, ISIS won't be taking over Mount Zion. And I think you wrote Sinai here, which is, if you did, it may be Sion, I can't read your writing, but Zion, Z-I-O-N, in the Greek language is S-I-O-N, transliterated. But Sinai, of course, is where Moses received the Ten Commandments. ISIS will not be taking over Jerusalem. And is God not changing the earth to its original form, putting it back the way it was? Is God going to do that? Yes, he will. Revelation chapter 21, the first view, verse 1, talks about a new heaven and a new earth. And they are going to be rejuvenated back to their original form in which he created the earth, which he did create to be inhabited. This is from, I can't read, Arkansas. I heard that this stated, if you are in the field, don't be the first taken. Where is the scripture does it say this? Matthew chapter 24, verse 40. Then two shall be in the field, and one shall be taken, and the one other left. And I've heard entire sermons, unfortunately, mistaught that you want to be the one taken and not the one left behind. In other words, taken in the rapture. I, for one, will stay here in the field working until Jesus Christ, the true Jesus Christ, returns at the seventh trump. There's work to be done here. We don't need to be flying away. Christine in New Jersey, is there a such thing as curses, as in people making curses on other people? No, but God can certainly curse his children. Leviticus chapter 26 and Deuteronomy chapter 28. Now, there are some people who would like for you to think that they have the power to curse you with their voodoo dolls, etc. But if you are a Christian, you have the power over all of your enemies, including voodoo dolls. You order negative and evil away from you in the name of Jesus Christ, and their curses will roll off of you like water off of a duck's back. Marge from Virginia. God's elect, when they are delivered up before Satan to testify, are they in the flesh or spiritual body? They're definitely still here in the flesh body. Why? Because Jesus hasn't returned yet, and that's when flesh is done away with. In other words, are the elect only the people living in flesh at that time? At that time, no. There will be flesh men on earth until Jesus returns, both elect and non-elect. Monica in New Mexico, why are deformed babies born? I had two babies that were born without limbs, and I never took any drugs or alcohol. Monica, we're sorry for that, and we know that makes life difficult, but I understand, we live in a polluted world. I can promise you that your two children will be whole in their spiritual bodies. And I would point out another scripture to you, 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 13, which tells us that there's nothing that's going to happen to us, to you, that isn't common to man. That means that it hasn't happened to someone else before, and that God will never allow you to be tested above or tempted above what you're able to handle without providing you a way out. Linda in Georgia, please explain Matthew 27, 3 through 8. I don't understand Judas when he threw the money back and the point where he hung himself. Well, in verse 3, it states of Matthew 27, it states that Judas repented. And you know, a lot of people think, or I've heard people say, that Judas should go to hell. Well, you know, Judas shouldn't go to hell if he truly repented and obtained forgiveness from our Father. Do I hate what he did? Yes, I hate what he did. Do I hate Judas? No, I don't hate Judas, especially if he repented and obtained forgiveness. But it does say there in Matthew 27 that he took the blood money that the fake high priest had given him to turn Jesus in, and he threw it down on the floor of the temple. In other words, he was returning their blood money to them. And then it states that he went and hung himself. In Acts chapter 1, verse 18, we learn that he had some help hanging himself. You see, what the chief priests that were appointed by the Roman government that was in control of Jerusalem at the time, what they had done was illegal, way, way, way illegal, hiring someone to bring about someone else's death. They couldn't afford to have Judas around to witness against what they had done. So it states in Acts chapter 1, verse 18, that he fell headlong, burst asunder in the midst, and his bowels gushed out. That's like saying the guy that shot himself in the head 10 times committed suicide. Judas had some help. Jim in Colorado. In the book of Isaiah, it says, in that day, seven women will come to one man and says, let us take thy name to take away our reproach. Please tell me what this is talking about. And it's Isaiah chapter 4, verse 1 is where that scripture is. The seven women are symbolic of the 7,000 who will not bow a knee to Baal or Satan. The man, of course, is the bridegroom, which is Jesus Christ. And when they say, let us be called by thy name, it's saying if someone follows Christ, what is your name that you're called by? You're called a Christian. And that's what Isaiah chapter 4, verse 1 is talking about. Donna in Missouri, please tell me what church you're affiliated with. We are a Christian, non-denominational church. We are not affiliated with anyone, nor do we have any affiliates. Shirley in Texas. I heard Enoch was called up into the third heaven and wrote some of the Bible there. He put on a white gown, and the Lord told him what to write. Then he walked with God, and then he was no more. He was taken away. He was not going to heaven alive like Elijah. So Moses and Elijah showed up in Revelation. What happened to Enoch? He no longer was mentioned. Is he going to be one of them that shows up in the Transfiguration? Boy, I don't know where you read all this about Enoch and the white gown. It was not in a King James Version Bible. Enoch was favored by God. Why? Because he was teaching the truth about what the fallen angels were doing with the daughters of Adam, that they were lying with them and polluting the seed line through which Messiah was to come. Enoch was transfigured just like Elijah was transfigured, and I believe Moses was transfigured as well. Matthew chapter 17, who is it that appeared on the Mount of Transfiguration when Christ was transfigured? Moses and Elijah. Alfred in Georgia, what is the name of the place where the flood was? Well, the entire world was flooded, the name of the place was the world. I think you mean where did the ark come to rest, possibly. And you won't find that in the Bible. That's not biblically recorded. History has it that it happened on Mount Ararat, which is in Turkey, of today. Mount Ararat is some 16,854 feet above sea level. And as the flood waters receded, history has it that the Ark came to rest on Mount Ararat. And there is some archaeological finds there that tend to support that, I guess. Michael in Texas, what tribe was Elijah from? Not written what Elijah was, other than it states that he was a Tishbite, which is of Gilead, which is an area of Israel. What tribe was Isaiah from? That's not biblical, but tradition holds that Amos, the father of Isaiah, was the brother of Amaziah, king of Judah. Again, don't misquote me, that's not biblical, that's historical. Butch from South Carolina, thank you for your kind comments. My question, the word Kenite, I looked it up in the Strong's, it gave me numbers 7014 and 7017. Neither one said they were offspring of Cain. You're mistaken. Make sure, number one, you are in the Hebrew dictionary. 7017 states that it's Patron, abbreviation for 7014, which is Cain. Patron, go to the first of your dictionary, and it'll explain Patron is an abbreviation for patronymic. That means children from the father's side. That means children of Cain. I'm out of time. I love you all a great deal. Why? Because you enjoy studying his word in depth. We are brought to you by your tithes and offerings. If we've helped you, help us keep coming to you and to reach out to others who are lost in this world of darkness. Most important this, you stay in his word every day. Every day in your Father's word is a good day. I'm talking about days when trouble is everywhere. Do you know why? It's because Jesus is the living word.
Hearing God's word with understanding will change your life. We hope you have enjoyed studying God's word here on the Shepherd's Chapel Family Bible Study Hour with Pastor Dennis Murray. If you would like to receive more information concerning Shepherd's Chapel, you may request our free introductory offer. Our introductory offer contains the Mark of the Beast CD, our monthly newsletter with a written Bible study, a CD catalog, and a list of written reference works available through Shepherd's Chapel. To request our free introductory offer by telephone, call 800-643-4645, 24 hours a day. You may also request our introductory offer by writing to Shepherd's Chapel, P.O. Box 416, Gravette, Arkansas, 72736. Once again, that's Shepherd's Chapel, P.O. Box 416, Gravette, Arkansas, 72736. We invite you to join us for the next in-depth Bible study each weekday at the same time. Thank you for watching today's program, and God bless you.
This has been a long time I've been promising a children's book. This is a book that will help a parent teach their child exactly what God's word states. Now, this was done by a very good friend and student of this chapel. We have given it, if you would, a binder whereby if there is a page that you feel is too far advanced for your children, then by all means you should remove that particular page. It is done in a material that is even washable, and it takes you step by step into instructing a child what does God's word say. And I think you will find it extremely helpful. It is item number 4414. Thank you.
Arkansas. This is Shepherd's Chapel with Pastor Arnold Murray. Join with us now as Pastor Murray takes you on a book-by-book, chapter-by-chapter, line-by-line study of God's Word. Now, here is Pastor Murray.
All right, good day to you. God bless you. Welcome to the Shepherd's Chapel. Welcome to this Family Bible Study Hour. Well, praise God, we're ready to do a little looking here in our Father's Word, see what He could offer us. I want to go to our teletype, the Reuter Wire Service, for a few minutes.